Hey, everybody, everybody, boy, it's your main man, Anthony Brogdon, back at you once again, and I got a sister on the channel today. Let me tell you, my brothers and my sisters out there in the world, that I went to high school with this sister. I'm telling you, and she's smart, too. She was getting all A's through high school. I went to one of them special high schools here in Detroit. Y'all know that's where I record from. That's where I'm based out of. That's my hometown. All right? And I went to this special high school. It's called Cass Tech. I ain't got time to do no shout out to my CTers out there in the world. But nonetheless, I've admired this lady for a long time. And so what happened was, y'all know I do a little public speaking myself here, you know, result of the channel. And, oh, man, let me back up. I'm so excited. My name is Anthony Brogdon. Y'all might not, I forgot to tell you who I am. I'm Anthony Brogdon because I'm excited to have this sister on the channel, right? And so I've been doing this for a while now. We almost said 2 years. And we over almost 500 videos. And it's people like this sister who take time out of their busy schedule to come on here, because this is where you find Black history, straight no chaser, from the people who want to tell it from whatever angle they tell it. We're going to give it to you. One way or the other, we're going to enlighten your mind with some of this. And that's what this sister's going to do. So I was speaking, and I do a lot of that now, even more so. At an event, and it was for Juneteenth.
Yep.
It was for Juneteenth. And she was in the audience, sitting there looking attentively at what I was saying. I said, man, and it wasn't just her. I think I had the crowd out of silence, because I gave it to them. I told them some Juneteenth stuff that most people didn't know. You know, I do the research, right? And so then she came up to me. She says, you know, I love Black history, and I've been to Africa and this, that, and the other. And I said, whoa. And I said, got me to thinking, hey, you make a good candidate to come on Strong Inspiration. She said, I want to do it. Yeah. But I'm taking some classes on some history, so wait till I come back. And so here we are, my friends. Everybody, I love doing this for you. This has become my mission and my passion to let you hear these stories. And I've done it on a number of fronts. One front, and it all maybe is where it began, when I did this documentary right here, is the DVD. Nobody got DVD players. I understand that. I got a few of them laying around here. But it's titled Business in the Black, The Rise of Black Business in America. Somehow, I stumbled across this history topic of Black folks who were enslaved to own businesses. I had never heard that before. They weren't gonna teach me that. That would have made me a monster, everybody, to know that there were brothers and sisters, and she's got a story that you need to hear that sets the level of the playing field for us Black folks. Watch this. So when I found that out, I did the documentary. I took the documentary to about 40 cities across America. And which was big. One of them that I, you know, all of them I love, but the one that really kind of made me cry was Tulsa, Oklahoma, when they brought me there to the Black Wall Street. That was huge. They gave me a plaque from the state of Oklahoma and the city of Tulsa. Unbelievable. Little old me trying to do something extraordinary. And then from that, I wrote this book, everybody. It's titled Black Business Book. The book is the number one Black history book on the market. You got to get you a copy of this. It's like the movie, but it has even more facts. Not just how slaves went to college, and not just how slaves owned business, not just how slaves bought their freedom, but I tell you a little bit of what the federal government did to try to help Black people after slavery. But then what they did when they got tired of helping us, and they let that Jim Crow and all that other stuff happen, and how they destroyed Black business districts. So it's got a lot of good, and it's got a lot of not so good, but it's a good angle on it, right? That's how I do it, everybody. Now, you hear me use this term strong a lot. Strong is my favorite word. I've been saying strong for a long time. And in my world, strong stands for strength, tenacity, resilience, and a sense of oneness, nobility, and grace. And that is my introduction to my guest today. She's a strong soul sister coming out of my town and a classmate of mine. Come on, introduce yourself. Let's get it on. Thank you for being on Strong Inspiration.
Hello, Anthony. It is a pleasure to be here with you. Boy, you start this show out with some excitement. And I love it. And you've always been that way. I've not known you to come out like this with passion and excitement. So I appreciate your asking me to be on. It was really wonderful running into you on Juneteenth. And I know you had a captive audience, and there were people of all ages, children all the way to seniors. And we love what you had to say. There's never a time when we shouldn't be learning about our past and our history. And so I'm passionate about it as well. So I wanted to just talk a little bit.
Let me stop you. Stop you. Tell us your name.
Oh, see, I'm excited too. Yeah, I forgot to tell you my name. My name is Joy Downs Young, and I was born and raised in Detroit, still living close by. And that's why you caught me hanging out in the city. I grew up over near Livernois, on Livernois and 7 Mile. And so I was just back over there enjoying interacting with the folks on Juneteenth and celebrating. Yes.
Now, I'm gonna let you go from here. But how did you come to like Black history? What was the first inclination for you?
You know, I used to go to family reunions down in Mississippi with my family when I was a girl, and my dad and his brothers, he had 7 brothers, and they would sit around and they would be talking about things that happened in the past. And my dad was the youngest, and he was born in 1916. So one of his brothers was born in 1900 and a sister was born in 1898. So I have an aunt that was born in 1898. So we are not that far removed from slavery. You know, my grandparents were born in the 1870s up to 1890. And so I used to listen to them talk, and it was fascinating to me. So I would go down there for reunions when I got to be a little older, and I would stop in Jackson at the archives, and I would just start doing some research, look at the microfilm and look for books and things like that about our family. And I was able to find some things. Then we got computers around 1991. I got my first internet browser, Prodigy. I don't know if you remember Prodigy.
Yeah.
As soon as I got it, I started going online, and I found family members just from going on Mississippi websites and doing queries. And I actually met family members that I had never heard of before.
Really?
And that got me started. Yeah, I've been doing it ever since.
Okay, I'm getting a little personal in just a second here, if you don't mind. What's it like going to Mississippi from the North? How was that experience? Did they treat you differently, you big city girl and all that kind of stuff? How was that?
You know, you might be a little bit surprised. Our family is from a city called Macomb, Mississippi. It's in Pike County. And I've been going down there, like I said, since I was a little girl. And, you know, I have never been mistreated down there. I have not once been mistreated and by anybody. People have been, you know, I'm thinking that the people that would mistreat me weren't in the places where I was. People have been kind. And it's been a really good experience. And my dad told me that it was similar when he was growing up. Now, that didn't mean that there wasn't stuff. You know, one story I had, my dad said his brother was about 4 years older than him. The outcome was great, but he went to jail for either talking to, looking at, or saying something to, you know, a white woman at a county fair. And he went to jail for it. So, I mean, I'm not saying that there wasn't a lot there, but my experience is we're good. I went down there in July, this past July, for a family reunion.
Okay.
And it was a great experience.
Okay. Let me ask you this. And I mean, no disrespect in this, because I'm in the same quilt. Being lighter complected means what?
I don't think that had any difference, because I wasn't with people that were just light complected. I have cousins of all hues, and we were all there together. We were all interacting in the city, going to different places. They were not mistreated. None of us were mistreated. So, like I said, I don't know if where I was had something to do with it, and maybe out in certain areas it was different.
Yes.
But I did not. We did not have a problem, and it didn't have. I don't think it had anything to do with that.
I gotta ask you this one, then. Again, no disrespect. I know where the white is in my family.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know where it is in yours?
I do know some of it, yes. Yes, I have done some research, and I have found that the same surnames, I found surnames of my people in Mississippi, And when I looked at census records, and I learned what you do is you go back to 1870 on the census record, you find your family, and if you find that pretty much everybody in that on those pages are black, they usually live on the same land. And that land was probably land that was owned by an enslaver prior to that. And what I found was the same people with the same last names lived in those same areas right where we did. So I did some DNA tests through a couple different companies and I found the match to them. So I was able to find out who they were.
Would you want to meet them? That those who are alive now, understandably.
I wouldn't mind meeting them, but I mean, there's so many black family members that I'd like to meet that I haven't met yet. That I've been finding them one by one. I actually did a DNA test and I connected with a cousin in New Orleans. They invited me down and there were 40 of them. And my daughter and I went and they laid out the red carpet. They had a feast for us and the whole family
Really?
was there. It was great. It was great. And made the gumbo, best gumbo I've ever had. Took us all.
Yes.
So that was amazing. So going down there and meeting people that I met through DNA is fine. I actually did meet a cousin. I went to a National Genealogy Society meeting back in June, and there was a man there who was a DNA cousin, and he and I are connected through the enslaving part of the history.
He's a black guy or white guy?
He's a white guy, and I've got a picture with him. But
Really?
we have the same surnames. We traced each other back to a common ancestor. Yep.
Was there any brutality in your family or any of that type thing that you know of? Were they
Absolutely.
go?
Absolutely. So if I
Oh,
go
really?
back to, it's there. And being from Mississippi, it's going to be there. So I actually have a little article, if I can get my technology to work right here. But I have a great grandfather who was born around 1830, and he's a great grandfather. He's not even a great 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 or anything like that. He is a great grandfather. He's my grandfather's dad. But I found a newspaper article about him. One of the things about him is that he had land. He owned land there, and I have the records that show the homesteading that he did and how he had to improve on his land in order to buy it. How the neighbors and the community helped him to improve his land, and he did the same for them. And then they got this land through the government. And so they had a black organization in Pike County, and it was called the Planters Alliance. And it was a black organization. It was a part of a bigger organization, the National Black P Planters Alliance, but this was the local one. He was the president of this alliance, and he and other family members would get together and they would encourage and help one another to be economically strong through farming. And so he was well known in the community, and I found out that he was murdered. And we had always heard that. We had always heard Grandpa Edmund was murdered, and I wanted to find some proof. Well, what was it? So I found this little article. I'm gonna read it to you. It's real short.
Sure.
It says Magnolia, Mississippi, July 10th, 1893. Edmund Downs, and let me just stop here. Vernacular and words in the past is different than what we use now. So they use different names for black people. They use color, they use Negro, they use mulatto, they use all different kind of terms. But I'm gonna read what it said. So this is what it said back in 1893.
Sure.
It said, Edmund Downs, a worthy colored man, was waylaid Saturday night and shot to death while going to attend a meeting of his Masonic lodge. The shooting took place near a country store 1 mile south of Holmesville, Mississippi. The weapon used was a shotgun, and 31 shot took effect in the back and head of the man. He fell from his horse, a corpse. So I found that, and I'm like, wow, that was in a newspaper article. It said and this was a white paper. They didn't have a black paper in this area.
What's
It
the
said
name of the paper?
it's called the Magnolia Gazette, and it says he fell from his horse, a corpse. The deceased was an honest, hardworking man, highly esteemed by his neighbors. And if he had an enemy, no one knew it. There is no clue to the assassin. The coroner is investigating the case, and the jury of inquest is composed of some of the most prominent citizens of the neighborhood. It is supposed that Downs was shot by mistake for Owen Brewer, who killed somebody else in another county a few weeks ago and who was supposed to be hiding in the vicinity. So we don't know whether that's true or not. But we surmise, could they have been jealous that he had this farm and he was doing all these things? The other thing is, at that same time is when the Ku Klux Klan began to come out and operate. And so one of the things that we learned, and I still have to verify this with documentation, but what we have been told is that one of their initiation rites was to kill Black people. And so my great-grandfather wasn't the only person who was shot on his horse and left for dead on the road. Another cousin, his cousin, that happened to him around the same time. So I do need to find more documentation about, you know, Ku Klux Klan activity and was that kind of a typical thing.
Let me ask you this. And when we talk about, and I'm diverting, just, I'm not diverting, I'm just going to, what kind of devastation could that have been on a family? I mean, you know, you got a hardworking brother who, is he married at the time and got kids, and the kids have to now hear this about their dad and so on and so forth?
He was only 50 some years old. He had 21 children, Tony. He had 21 children. And he left a wife who was my great grandmother. And she left her there with 21 children.
She had 21 kids?
Between the two of them, yep. They had 21 children. She had three before they got married. He had three before they got married. Yep. Yep. And then they had 15 of their own.
Ooh-wee.
Yep. So that was devastating.
Sure.
For her. You know, she probably lived until 1922. She lived until about 1922. So she was a widow for a long time. She never remarried. Those kids took.
Have you been to the spot where that supposedly happened?
Don't know exactly where it happened. I would love to know exactly where it happened. So I would have to go back down there, try to pull up more information and see if I can find it. I know where Holmesville is. So, I mean, I know the general area. It's not that big of an area. But I would have to go down there, figure out where the Masonic Lodge was, where his land was, and then try and follow a route from there to there, and at least to get an idea. So
is his land still in your family?
His land is not in the family anymore, not to our knowledge. No, no. So I do have more research to do on it. But one of the things he did was he inspired his sons to go on and do amazing things as well. So my grandfather also owned land. And I do know where his land is. We actually can go down there and go on the land, which is where our family cemetery is.
Oh.
So yeah, I do know where his land is and some of his other family.
Well, you said family cemetery. What does that mean?
That means on our grandfather's land, which his wife is the one who owned the land. And when he married her, he got the land. But her dad, who also had been enslaved and was also part of the Planters Alliance and also was a very good friend of my great grandfather, he was able to secure 320 acres of land, and he was able to will that land to his daughter. So my grandmother had 80 acres of land, and on that land there's a cemetery back there, and you can go back there and there are graves of. We have a doctor in our family. He went to Meharry and he graduated in the 1880s. He's buried in that cemetery. You know, we have my grandfather who was a minister. He was a itinerant preacher who went to a couple of different churches in Mississippi. He's buried there. So there are a lot of family members in that cemetery. I'm actually in the process of trying to get it preserved and protected, which is a big process because right now it's on the land of a lumber company, and I just don't want them to go through there and try to get rid of lumber and say, "Oops, you know, we
gotcha.
Oops, we didn't."
Are
we
there
didn't
tombstones, headstones, any of that kind of thing?
They're there, but it's very embedded in the forest. I know exactly where it is. My brother and I, and my brother knows your brother, so you and I graduated together. Our brothers graduated younger than us, but we went to that cemetery and we took some tape, you know, some crime scene tape, that yellow tape. And we actually went from tree to tree and we tied it. So I would tie it in one place. My brother would stand there. I go to the next tree, we tie it. And we went around until we tied a circle around each of those trees so that it would be encircled. And I'm sure by now it's way up somewhere, you know, in the sky, if it's even still there.
Because the trees grew is what you mean. Yeah.
It's so dark in there, you wouldn't even know it was daylight. That's how dense it is in there.
Really?
Yeah. So, but we want to get it secured. Might take some legal action, but that's okay.
Well, okay. I guess the question is why? What does this do for you? I mean, yeah, what is, yeah,
It's
why?
our history. It's where we come from. It's the people before us. I know people pray for me. I never met not one grandparent, but those people pray for me. Those people, I have history from them. They struggle. They struggled and they survived and they thrived. And I have their pictures. I have their pictures in the room with me. I'm looking at a picture of my great grandfather Edmund, who was killed. I can pull it down and let you see him.
Please do. Let me see. Let me see it. Let me see it.
I will.
If
I
you don't
will. But
mind.
I
Yeah.
look at them. It when life gets hard for me, I trust in the Lord, and I also know that He gave me ancestors to be my models. When life gets hard for me, I look at their faces and I think about what they went through, and I'm like, you know what? I'm not gonna let them down. I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna
Wow,
keep.
beautiful.
That's what they did. They he was a slave. He was enslaved. He ended up owning land. He ended up doing all these things. That's important. It's important to know where we came from. Your
I
sense of
love
identity.
it.
So this is my great grandfather Edmund and his wife Caroline, that had the 21 children from Mississippi. Yep. I also heard that he was a Civil War soldier on the Union side, and I'm trying to find that information as well.
Okay.
And that he was my, they always kept saying, he marched down from Vicksburg. He marched down from Vicksburg. And the Battle of Vicksburg was a turning point in the Civil War for the North.
Yes. Yeah, that's right.
So I really want to find more out about him.
Yeah.
I think he's a handsome dude. I think he got some
He
handsome
is. And she is too.
grandmother is pretty. Yep.
Yeah.
So this is a picture of my dad and his brothers. I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah, well, there you go.
So that's my dad right there, the little fella. And then these are
Yeah.
his brothers. And this one was born in 1900. So,
Yeah.
and they all went to college, the ones that survived. Every one of them went to college. And that's what I'm saying. I have to keep going. They wanted
Yeah.
to do things, they wanted to live and
Love
do
it.
things for others, helpful and help other people. And that's important. And I hope everybody gets excited about their history, because everybody
Yes.
has a story.
Yes, that's right.
Everybody has a story. Everybody has contributed something.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
I read a story today. I'm always learning about it. I read a story today about an enslaved man who came to Michigan. He was in Farmington Hills, which was a very big abolitionist area. So there was a lot of Underground Railroad activity in Farmington Hills. That was a big Quaker area, and they were very, very important in doing things for people to help them get to freedom. So
Sure.
anyway, this young man, he was poor, he was bedraggled, he didn't have anything to his name. He was trying to get to Canada, and he stopped at this man's house, and he said, "Do you have, even 76 cents to give me the fare to be able to get down to the river so I can get across the river?" And the white man said, "I'm sorry, I don't have anything for you. I don't have anything for you. All I have are these papers." And he gave him a paper that this white man had wrote a poem about being enslaved. Now, this is coming, I don't know where he got his inspiration. I don't know if somebody black told him about it, but he wrote this poem as if he was a black person. Brought me to tears when I read it. And some years later, he was in downtown Detroit, and this black guy came up to him and he said, "Do you remember me, Mr. Roberts? Do you remember me?" And he said, "No, I'm sorry, I don't remember you." And he said, "Do you remember giving a black man who was enslaved some papers?" And he said, "Yeah, I remember that, the poem that I wrote." He said, "I went to Canada and I made copies of it, and I sold each copy for 25 cents." Now, that was a lot of money back in those days. And he said, "And now you see me now, I'm prospering." He said, "That was better, the best thing you could have given me. More than 76 cents, you gave me the ability to become a prosperous black man,
Wow, what a
free."
story.
No, and there's so many of them. And
Yes.
that man, he's got descendants. He has descendants. They might be living in Detroit right now and don't know anything
Yes.
about that.
Okay, now let me divert now
You know
then,
what I
because
mean?
you've opened the door to Detroit. How did your family get to Detroit? What was that migration? Did you know that story?
Yeah, that's interesting. So my dad, like I said, was from Mississippi. He was in the Air Force. He was a fighter pilot in World War II, Tuskegee Airman. And when the war was over, he was stationed here at Selfridge Air Force Base. A lot of the Tuskegee Airmen came to Detroit, and they were stationed at Selfridge. So that's where he was. And while he was here, he got his degree at Wayne State. in special education. And my mother is from New Orleans. And she went to Dillard, an HBCU. My dad went to Alcorn, an HBCU. And she came up here as a nurse. She graduated from Dillard as a nurse. And she came up here and they met. And
that's how
how
it
I'm
all
here.
Happened. Yeah. Now, because you're a Detroiter, you've done some research. I'm diverting everybody, but I'm getting it all in. You've done some research on slavery in Detroit. Tell us a little bit about that.
What I did was, in trying to learn about freedom seekers in Detroit, I said, well, let me go back and see what happened during slavery. And I found a book, and it was called The Dawn of Detroit, Chronicle of Slavery and Freedom in the City of the Straits, Straits. And I found that Straits meant waterways, and that's what Detroit means. Detroit is waterways.
Right.
And so the French had control of Detroit. Right before the Revolutionary War, and they made their money by trapping.
Right.
And so this book shared, you know, what happened. The French came in, they took the land of the Native Americans, they basically enslaved them and or made them indentured servants up till the age of 30. And they used their skill of trapping to be able to get furs, and that's how their economy flourished in Detroit.
Right.
Okay, and then they decided, okay, we're going to bring in some slaves, some black people as enslaved people. And so between 1760 and 1850, black people and Native American people were considered slaves. Okay, they were considered property. 1760 and 1815, I'm sorry. So there weren't that many of them, but the ones that they brought were slaves. A lot of them brought their own. They brought them from Canada, where the French lived. And then what happened is Britain took over, and they were the ones who conquered France and kind of booted them out. And Britain became the colonizers of Detroit. And they brought their slaves with them. They also had slaves sent to Detroit from other places where they lived, like New York and Boston and things like that.
Okay.
So that fur trade is what built Detroit. And then they traded furs and they traded people. So they used them to, you know, make the economy strong, but also to have people to take care of them, you know, do their farming, do their housework, raise their children, just like they did in the South.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, is it known to be brutal like it was there?
Yes. It was known to be brutal, although, you know, we don't know all the real stories of what happened, but, you know, we're always going to have the desire to be free. You know, you don't really ever see anybody who is controlled, who doesn't want to break through that. We were people, we weren't property, but that's how we were seen. We were treated as property.
You're
always going to want to get free. I don't care how well anybody treats you.
That's right.
They're controlling your every move. You're going to want to be free.
That's right. That's right.
And for them, you know, when the French were here, the French were the ones who also colonized Canada, and they had slavery over there. So at that point in time, going to Canada wasn't helping them. They weren't going to be free there until Britain took over. And then Britain abolished slavery. And when Britain abolished slavery, Canada was a British territory. And that's when you could go to Canada and be free. And they still weren't treated real well over there, but they were free.
Now you talk about how they lived in Canada and escaped from America, from Detroit. How did they normally make that escape? You had to cross that river, I'm sure, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, you did. You had to cross the river. A lot of them came up through Kentucky and then through Ohio, Indiana, and then that's when they got into Michigan. And so the Underground Railroad, you had people who were quietly and in the underground helping people get away from their enslavers. You know, in 1850, there was the fugitive slave law, which meant if you ran away and you came up north and the bounty hunters came up to get you, legally, they could take you back.
That's right.
And so what would happen is people would come up to Michigan and they'd find safe houses and places to stay. They'd find work and they would get paid so that they could save money for their families to go over to Canada. and fugitive slave hunters would come up here and they'd be looking for these slaves. So let's say that there was a slave in Ann Arbor, an enslaved person in Ann Arbor, and a fugitive slave hunter came up here. The Underground Railroad was such that they had a communication system. They might then send that enslaved person to Birmingham, Michigan. And the Underground Railroad person there would house them and hide them until they found out that that fugitive slave hunter had left. Then they'd send them back to Ann Arbor or Adrian or Grand Rapids or someplace like that. And
Right.
then they would have them go across the river. And it
And
wasn't
no,
just,
go ahead.
it was not just Detroit River, but it was from Sarnia up to Canada as well. So there were a lot of different places where they could go across the waterways and get to Canada.
I guess it's kind of amazing to know that, okay, there's a slave catcher down the street there, and I guess they know that's what he does.
Yes.
And then knowing that's what he does, knowing that he's looking for anybody black, I don't know if he's looking for somebody in particular.
Somebody in particular, the enslavers would send those bounty hunters up here to try to find them. And of course, there were people up here who wanted that bounty. They wanted that money.
Oh, there you go. That's the missing link, right?
You had the anti-slavery folks working hard. Right. And they might live next door to somebody who was pro-slavery. So they had to be real stealthy about
I got you. I
trying.
got you. I got you. What's next for you in your research?
Well, I want to do more research and I want to do better research. So I went to a genealogy society. Actually, it was a family search program in Utah. I did it virtually, like we're doing today. And one of the ladies said, the best way to learn how to be a researcher is to do it hands-on. You know, you can get all the book learning you want, but to really do it is to help you really know how to do it. So I learned about this museum, and the museum had an exhibit all about Black people trying to get to slavery, Black people settling in Michigan, especially in Oakland County, and all the people that were working on the Underground Railroad. And I said, oh, I want to go to that. So I went to this exhibit and I was blown away. I was blown away. They had a huge map, 6 by 6 feet map with the whole state of Michigan. And they had little pins on every city where there was an Underground Railroad station. And there were tons of them. And I had no idea that the Underground Railroad in Michigan was so expansive, including in Detroit. And there were Black abolitionists and white abolitionists. And they all worked together to try and help these people become free. So that was really exciting to me. And I said, oh, I think I want to work here. So I told the lady, I said, you need a volunteer to do some research? And she said, yep. So since June, I volunteer at this museum, which their whole focus right now is on abolition and slavery and freedom. And it's the Birmingham Museum in Birmingham, Michigan. Who would have thought? Who would have
Yes,
thought?
that's right.
Everybody there, their whole focus is let's tell the story of these people who had to go through slavery, who had to try and get to freedom, and all the things they went through, as well as the people that helped them, Black and white. So that's where I'm working now,
I love it.
as a volunteer.
I
And that's
love
so that
it.
I can do more research eventually and help other people find their family.
Yes.
You know, that's
It,
why I'm
it,
doing it.
it, 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 you want to write a book?
Down the line, first I want to
Yeah.
write a book on family, my family history. That's
Yes.
what I'd like to do first, because I have a lot
Yes.
of family and we are all trying to find out stuff. So yeah, I'd
Yeah.
like to do that. And
Yeah.
then help other people write their family history books. That's really what I'm more interested in, is helping people find their family. And
I
I've
love
done that.
it.
I'm able to do
Yeah. Yeah. Is there a question that I have not asked you? Something that you said I wanted to tell and I didn't know to ask that or something. Anything that comes to mind?
No, not that I can
Not
think of.
that you can think of. Okay,
Yeah.
that happened. Now, I'm a good interviewer, everybody.
Okay.
But let me tell y'all, everybody, this is what I do here, Strong Inspirations. I find people who want to tell it and I let the folks tell it. I do my best just to ask them the questions from all facets. And you can see the passion in this young lady. She young because I'm young. We came out together. But you can feel it. This has become your calling.
Yes.
And you are fulfilling that. You even volunteering out of your special time so that you can continue your research.
Yeah, because people are so excited when they find, oh, this was my great grandfather, or, you know, I didn't know he lived here. I mean, it just takes a few minutes to sit down and help people figure out where they're from, and just little bits about things gives them a lot of sense of satisfaction.
I love it. I love it. This is what we do, is strong inspiration. I give it to you straight, no chasing, my friends. And so I want to say, and I mean this out of the bottom of my heart to my classmate, I want you to stay strong, stay safe, stay on your grind. I love what you're doing.
Well, thank you, Tony.
There you go.
Your passion and your excitement, you know, it feeds on each other.
Yes, it does. On each other.
And both of us love the history of our people. And that's really, right. really important. And I want other people to become excited about the history of our people.
That's right.
Yeah.
Me too. Everybody, thank you for being here. Thank you for watching me as Strong Inspiration. Oh, I got one thing to tell y'all, my viewers. I'm working on a movie. We filming it. It's called They Did It, about rich Black folks that lived in the 1800s. Somehow, I'm going to make sure you learn that topic. Either my movie, my book, or through the my documentary, my movie, my book, somehow, and now the movie. It'll be coming out.
Congratulations on your movie.
Yeah, thank you.
And I do have your DVD, and I have a DVD player, so I've watched it.
There you go. Everybody, with that, I'll say thank you again. Bye-bye, we out.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah.